So Matias Gomez Corrales is a PhD student in Carlos Prado's lab. He's going to talk about depth and its impact on restoration.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thanks for attending the session and coming to my talk. This part of my research, of my dissertation research, was done in collaboration with the Iglesias Fierro's lab at the Penn State University. So we know coral reefs are under threat worldwide, particularly one of the most impacted regions in terms of coral cover decline has been the Caribbean region, where coral reefs that used to have 30 or 40 years back ago coral cover around 40 or 50% have seen important declines and are well below 20 or even less percent of the original hard coral cover. So this has forced us to take active measures, and one of those measures has been in the shape of outplanting, where we go out to the reefs, we collect naturally occurring fragments or colonies, we bring them back, we raise them in nurseries where we can have some control of the conditions with the idea that once they look good enough, we can then put them back on whatever reefs that we consider need repopulating, and then hopefully they can grow and reproduce, contributing to repopulating those reefs. And this works very well when we have a species that have a high degree of morphological plasticity or that are able to live very well no matter where you find them across environmental gradients on coral reefs, such as the one exemplified here, where we hope that because of the high degree of morphological plasticity, no matter where they come from and where you put them back, you hope they're gonna do well in the end. However, we do know that coral reefs are highly structured ecosystems across depths, not only in terms of the species distribution, but also in the morphologies that they have. So in shallow areas, we tend to have branching corals, and as we move deeper, those corals are being replaced by other species that have more flattened or platy-like shapes. And when it comes to why this is so, we know that one of the major structuring factors is light availability, because as we know, it's not only the amount of light that changes as we move deeper into the column water, it's also the quality of that light, which doesn't come as a surprise given the interdependence that reef-building corals have on their endosymbiotic algae for energy acquisition. And still even more, we know that light availability or light exposure varies greatly among reefs. So the one that you're seeing here is one particular reef that has a high degree of environmental gradient in terms of light availability. So as you can see, colonies that are, this the pointer? Yeah, so colonies that you see that are around 20 or 15 meters are actually getting a very tiny fraction of the original light that colonies in shallow areas are seeing. So it is within this context that I'm interested in understanding what happens within at the population level, within population, across a depth gradient. And for this, I'm using Orbicella fabulata as a model system, a species that most of you are familiar with, broadcast spawner, widely distributed across the Caribbean region and also the Gulf of Mexico, and that we also know that can occupy a broad depth range. So as part of my research, I have characterized some morphological traits at the within colony level across this light gradient and at Media Luna Reef. And as you can see here, we found that colonies in the shallow area around 5 meters versus colonies in the deep environment around 20 meters, they do differ in the number of polyps that they have per unit given area. So we believe that this difference or trend in the number of polyps, it is to do with how well they are able to deal with light and how they are able to utilize light available at different depths. So this led us to ask this question, and the question is, does morphological disparity actually correlate with physiological performance and survivorship across depths? So in order to address this question, we conducted a reciprocal transplant where we took advantage of microfragmentation method in order to have replicability and to have multiple frags from the original colonies. And we collected 40 colonies from the deep, shallow environment and another set of 40 colonies from the deep environment around 19 meters. And we produce a total grant of 1,600 fracs. So as you can see here in the experimental design, 400 fracs from shallow to shallow, then another set of 400 from shallow to deep, and the other way around to complete the whole experiment. And then we look at the physiological performance or response and quantify survivorship over time. In terms of the physiological response and how we measure that, we use another subset of FRACs in order to have all the four different treatments or reciprocal transplant that we conducted for a total of 48 FRACs. We estimated total protein content, which is a proxy of how much tissue a colony has or a FRAC has, and also estimated synbion density as well as chlorophyll A to have a proxy of how much synbionts they harbor and also how much pigmentation they are being responsible for. Then we run photosynthesis irradiance curves where we measure the alpha or photosynthetic efficiency in order to understand how well they deal with that light or utilize that light, and also how much oxygen is being consumed during that process. So before I go into my results, just to orient you around here, I'm gonna show you the variable of interest along the x-axis here, and along the y-axis I'm gonna have the transplants, the native ones shallow to shallow on top, and deep to deep in the bottom, and the opposite depths right in the middle. So in terms of protein, what we found is that even though you tend to see that the colonies in the shallow environment, the native ones, tend to have more tissue compared to the deep ones, we didn't really find any statistical differences between the native ones, shallow to shallow or deep to one, or the reciprocal transplants. It is worth pointing out here that these FRACs were only in the field for around 8 to 9 weeks, and potentially that was not enough time for them to experience any substantial growth, and that might explain also what we see here. And obviously we also have a small data set for the physiological response. In terms of synbion density, we saw something similar, nothing really different, although in deep environment you tend to have less synbionts compared to the shallow ones. However, the means didn't differ significantly when we compared them statistically. However, in terms of chlorophyll A, we do see that deep colonies tend to have more than the shallow ones, potentially as a mechanism to compensate for the lack of light or low light environments. And we saw some interesting response that we were kind of expecting. Shallow to deep one increase their levels of chlorophyll A, again, as a mechanism to compensate for the lack of light, and also deep to shallow decrease, although not significantly compared to the native one, but significantly compared to the other reciprocal transplant. In terms of photosynthetic efficiency, we start now seeing that the shallow ones do differ respect to the deep ones, where the deep colonies are far more efficient in terms of how they're using the light, and therefore they are more photosynthetically efficient compared to the shallow ones. And we saw also that from deep to shallow, that photosynthetic efficiency decreased, again, here because they are used to seeing a lot of light and they don't need so much photosynthetic efficiency when they are exposed to high levels of light. In terms of oxygen consumption, what we found was that was an important difference from between shallow to shallow and deep to deep. However, the reciprocal ones, transplants kind of resemble the native values of those of the native ones, meaning that somehow the oxygen consumption conformed to the depth they were exposed at or that they were transplanted to. So to give you a brief summary of what we found in terms of physiological summary, here I'm comparing the native ones, shallow to shallow versus deep to deep. We didn't find any important differences in protein density or synbion density and chlorophyll A. However, we did find that the shallow colonies are less photosynthetic efficiently compared to the deep ones, and they respire more. Now, in terms of the reciprocal transplants, shallow to deep and deep to shallow, we didn't find important changes in protein density or synbion density, in protein content, sorry, or synbion density. However, we did find opposite trend of change, like in the shallow to deep, chlorophyll increased compared to deep to shallow, photosynthetic efficiency also increased from shallow to deep compared to deep to shallow, that decreased, and respiration decreased from shallow to deep, and deep to shallow increased. So the question is, how does this translate in terms of survivorship across time when we put them in the field? So we found this, and is that there are important differences in survivorship after 6 months. As you can see, potentially because deep colonies are far more efficient at utilizing light, you see that deep colonies, when they were put in the shallow environment, survivorship was pretty much the same. However, when we put colonies from the shallow environment down to the deep environment, there was an important decrease in survivorship. And this actually is in line with what has been shown from multiple studies. This is a meta-analysis put together by one of our postdocs in our lab, where she looked at different studies reporting reciprocal transplants, and she estimated increasing survivorship of native over foreign. And you see that for tumor kind of morphologies here, there is an important advantage in just putting colonies back to the native environment. But not only that, going back to our medial lunar reef and our Orbicella fabulata species, we also know from a genetic characterization from over 10,000 single nucleotide polymorphisms that there is an important differentiation in terms of lineages or genetic clusters between shallow and deep environment, as you can see here in this admixture plot, where we see that in shallow environment, we only see the red lineage, and as we go down, we start seeing a mix of blue and red lineage down to the point where at deep 19 meters, we only found a blue lineage. So this is showing us, as obviously this suggests, that these two lineages are reproductively isolated, which means that they are not interbreeding in the field, or if they are, those admixed individuals, that would be individuals that would be like 50% or 60, 40% blue and red, are extirpated at a later stage, and that's why we are not collecting them or seeing them when we conduct genetic analysis on adult colonies are the ones that we use for our experiments. And this, in fact, is something that is coming up over and over on multiple studies. This is just an example of a species, but many studies on different species have shown that there is an important segregation in terms of genetic lineages or genetic independent clusters across a depth gradient. Some of the earliest studies in Caribbean come from Unisa flexuosa, which is actually an octocoral, also Ceratopora hyxtrix from the Indo-Pacific. So this shows us that it's actually something in nature that keeps those lineages apart across an environmental gradient between habitats related to depth. So with that, to wrap up, I've shown you using Orbicella fabulata as a model species and also supported by multiple studies that, or supported from literature, that coral variation segregates across depths, not only in terms of morphology, but also physiology, as well as genetics. Which this suggests that it's consistent with adaptation to depth when we are measured survivorship across time. And finally, this also is important knowledge because matching donor and transplanted sites enhances survivorship over time of corals during coral restoration. So this knowledge is both applicable and desirable for coral reef practitioners and any of us who are doing coral restoration. So with that, I'd like to thank all the people involved in my research and that I have the pleasure of collaborating with, as well as the funders. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions.